Se reanuda la sesión número 3059 del Consejo de Seguridad.
The 3059th meeting of the Security Council is resumed. In keeping with the request made by the distinguished Deputy Prime Minister of Iraq yesterday morning, His Excellency Mr. Tariq Aziz, I intend to afford him the opportunity now to make a statement in response to the introductory statement made by the President on behalf of the Council and the questions and concerns expressed by the members in the course of the Council's deliberations yesterday. The distinguished Deputy Prime Minister of Iraq has the floor.
Thank you, Mr. President.
سيادة الرئيس
Mr. President,
إذا سمحتم فإنني سأبدأ بالتعليق
If you allow me, I would like to begin
التقرير الذي قدمتموه
by commenting on the report that you made yesterday
تقرير رئيس المجلس
as President of the Security Council
وبعد ذلك سأنتقل إلى الإجابة على الأسئلة
Then,
التي
I will move to answering the questions posed by a number of the distinguished representatives on the Council. In the statement of the President, which also refers to the report of the distinguished Secretary General on the 25th of January, as well as the 7th of March, on the state of compliance by Iraq with the obligations. Is talk about general obligations and specific obligations. As far as I understand, the Secretary General's report and your statement have concentrated on the specific commitments and obligations, and I would deal with them in my statement one after the other. One, respect for international borders. There is no essential problem as far as this is concerned. There is a minor problem, namely withdrawing of 5 police points. Iraq has asked that this be deferred until the demarcation of the borders has been dealt with. The report itself refers to the fact that the area has been calm since last October. The second point, Mr. President, in your statement and in the report of the Secretary General, in which there was an expression of importance by the Council and an interest that had to do with the weapons. First, the question of the destruction of the weapons and their subsystems.
في بياني ليوم أمس.
We would like to affirm what has been mentioned in the statement yesterday that all weapons banned under 687 and the subsystems, all these weapons have been destroyed.
المسألة الثانية هي مسألة البرامج والمعلومات الأخرى المتعلقة.
Programs and other information on the weapons.
إننا على استعداد.
We are ready.
للإعلان الكامل والشامل والنهائي.
To make full, complete and comprehensive declaration and disclosure of all programs having to do with Resolution 687. Once again, we are ready to announce fully, comprehensively and finally all aspects of Resolution 687. We are ready to enter immediately into technical detailed meetings with the Special Commission and the IAEA with a view to completing the map and the program for each of these programs, provided that we define a limited period of time before the Security Council for this mission. Afterwards, we would come back to the Council to make a report on that topic. The other side is to destroy or to render harmless the other phrase in 687 on equipment, relevant equipment or related equipment. Iraq is committed to the provisions of 687 as is. Iraq affirms its request in our statement yesterday that the interpretation of this question is not commensurate with the text or the letter of that resolution. That destruction has to be limited only to these equipment that can only be used in the production of the banned weapons. Other equipment which can be used for civilian purposes or other purposes that have not been banned, the Council in this respect is called upon to fulfill the legitimate request of Iraq in this regard, namely that they be converted or rendered harmless, converted to civilian production or production which has not been banned, and also to provide for the possibility of verification of their use in that particular context. As far as verification is concerned and verification in the future, Iraq has accepted the principle of verification and checking compliance in the future through the acceptance of Resolution 687. Iraq affirms its statement that it made yesterday on the fact that it's necessary to respect the necessities of national sovereignty and territorial integrity of Iraq. Iraq asks the Security Council to guarantee these principles. I request that my statement yesterday, that what has been mentioned in my statement yesterday in this respect be recorded. The understanding of the Council of the principles, basis of the legitimate requests made by Iraq in our statement would lead, of course, to a fair and just as well as objective application of the essential commitments required from Iraq in 707 and 715, and in a way that would reassure the Council. Our delegation, Mr. President, is ready to enter into a constructive and objective dialogue with the Special Commission and the IAEA with a view to providing the requested information and to reaching practical arrangements that fall within the mandate and the objective defined by the Security Council, but not to exceed that to serve either political or intelligence purposes. This is as far as the weapons are concerned. The third point in your report, which has been dealt with by several of the representatives, is the question of the prisoners or the detainees. In my statement yesterday, I have affirmed that we have asked on the 20th of February, we have asked for an official memo. We've asked an official memo to the ICRC. We've asked that the ICRC take care of this mission comprehensively and that the ICRC would take any steps to verify the realities. In our memo, we said that competent Iraqi authorities are ready to undertake whatever measures to publish the names of the missing, whether they are Kuwaitis, Saudis, or others in Iraqi newspapers. That the authorities are ready to arrange for visits by the representatives of the International Committee to prisons and detention camps in accordance with the rules and the Geneva Convention, that the authorities are ready to discuss the details of the publication, as I have mentioned yesterday, and the visits in talks with the head of the mission of the ICRC. In your statement, when you talked about the responsibility of Iraq under international law, the Council is aware that Iraq has accepted the resolutions that dealt with this question. It is worthy of mention in this respect that provisions in the resolutions in this respect provide for the responsibility of Iraq under international law. This means that we have to take into account the rules of international law when applying these provisions, so that when we ask for compensation under international responsibility, it should be based upon international legal provisions which provide for justice and fairness. Foremost among these in this respect is that these demands should not be vengeful or a way of making pure material gain when we open the way for claims that are not substantiated. Iraq is not represented in any way in the machinery that deals with these claims. And as we understand, this is not compatible with international law and the precedents in this respect. It is very important that we observe due process in law. That principle provides for the fact that we should establish a relationship between the mistake and the damage, the fault and the damage, that compensation would be the direct outcome of that responsibility, and inasmuch as the fault is being linked to that responsibility. These things are not provided for in international law when they are handled by one party. Justice demands proof, and in the case of proof, the concerned party should be represented directly. Mr. President, your report refers to various other questions. The report refers to the responsibility of Iraq vis-à-vis the debts and the interest. How can Iraq pay now debts and interest when there is an all-out embargo against Iraq before the Council? Here, I affirm that Iraq respects its obligations vis-à-vis debtor countries. We respect our obligations vis-à-vis countries that we owe debts to. Iraq cannot pay these debts or deal with the interest if the blockade has not been lifted, and if Iraq cannot export its oil, and if Iraq cannot go back to its normal economic situation. On this, and on the comments by the distinguished representative of Russia, the Russian Federation, I would like to remind that we have informed his government that Iraq respects its obligations toward the Russian Federation. We have informed a number of countries that we are willing and ready to pay their debts in crude oil. As far as I know, one or more of the countries have already contacted the Council or the Committee on Sanctions, and they have asked the Council and the Committee to approve their importation of Iraqi crude oil as payment for the debts on Iraq. However, the Committee on Sanctions has not yet reviewed these requests. Therefore, Iraq cannot bear any responsibility in that respect. However, Iraq remains committed to its obligation towards the countries to which it owes debts. As far as the return of property is concerned, I would like to quote what you mentioned in your statement, Mr. President, yesterday, where you said the Security Council members have noted with satisfaction that, as mentioned in the supplementary report of the Secretary General, Iraqi officials have extended the maximum amount of cooperation to the United Nations to facilitate the return of property. We believe that this is perfectly clear. The seventh and eighth points which were raised in the statement and dwelt on by a number of the distinguished representatives is the monthly statements on the bullion and of gold and foreign currency reserves holdings. This has to do with resolutions 706 and 712. I would like, Mr. President, to deal with 706 and 712 in detail. Under the provisions of 687, Iraq requested the Council or the Committee of Sanctions, Iraq requested that it be allowed to export an amount of oil that would allow to fulfill the human and basic needs of the Iraqi people, particularly foods and medicine. When Prince Sadruddin Aga Khan visited us, when he was heading the mission of the UNHCR, the executive delegate last summer, we discussed with him this question. He said that some of the members of the Security Council have raised doubts on the intentions of Iraq if Iraq were allowed to export an amount of its oil to purchase its legitimate needs of food and medicine. He said that these members say that Iraq may use this money for purposes other than purchasing food or medicine. In that meeting, the prince was accompanied by three people: Mr. Richardson, an American, a former Minister of Justice, Secretary of Justice, and Mr. Mobin, and a third person whose name I don't recall. I told them that if there is any doubt that Iraq would use this money for purposes other than purchasing food and medicine, there's a practical solution for this. We are ready to sell oil to the countries which are members of the Security Council. Many of the members of the Security Council were customers of Iraqi oil, including the United States, which used to purchase prior to August 1990 700,000 barrels a day of Iraqi oil. Also France, India, Japan, Russia, the former Soviet Union, and other countries are member of the Security Council, whether permanent members or non-permanent members. So these countries which took part in the adoption of the resolutions of the Council can make sure personally of the amounts that they are purchasing, and they can inform the Council. We are ready to buy food and medicine from These same countries, we used to buy from American market, from the US market, an estimated $1 to $1.7 billion of foodstuffs. We used to buy most of our needs of medicine and medical supplies from the British market. We used to buy most of our needs of food and medicine from France as well. These are three permanent members of the Security Council. We are ready to confine our purchases to the countries that are permanent members in the Security Council, so these countries can make sure whether we are using this money to buy food, medicine, or weapons, and therefore we can eliminate the doubts or concerns. These ideas, unfortunately, took form in Resolution 706, which was a resolution passed under Chapter 7, to export a limited amount of oil to secure the needs of Iraq of food and medicine. This requires a resolution under Chapter 7. This resolution, Mr. President, has political implications. Political implications that would lead to whether that was the intention or not, that would lead, I say, to an interference in the internal affairs of Iraq. We cannot accept that this question be turned into a political game, a political game to achieve political objectives that have nothing to do with the objectives of the Security Council. However, if the Council is still ready to look into this question, we remain ready to respond. We are ready to enter into talks, serious talks and practical talks with the Secretariat to find a solution for this question, namely to export an amount of Iraqi oil that would be enough to secure the humanitarian and basic needs of the Iraqi people, and that this operation be transparent and clear and be monitored by the United Nations. We are ready to enter into practical arrangements that would secure a transparency, a complete transparency that cannot be doubted, so that the Security Council and the United Nations can make sure that the price of that oil, the money of that oil, can only be used for purchase of food, medicine and basic human needs that are sanctioned by the Committee on Sanctions. I was asked, if Iraq was ready to continue the contacts that were started in Vienna last February. The answer is yes. We are ready, but without preconditions. We are ready to go into an open dialogue without prior conditions to reach what I have just mentioned, to reach a machinery agree on arrangements that would lead to the export of an appropriate amount of Iraqi oil, and also to reach an agreement on machinery that would be appropriate to secure transparency on the operations of selling and purchasing later on. I hope in this regard that the Council will not renew Resolution 706. I hope that the Council will not do this. I hope that we can separate this operation and not to include it in a resolution by the Council. Putting it in a resolution adopted by the Council is impractical. In addition to the political aspects that I have talked about, in addition to these, there are practical aspects. Machinery that we agree on with the United Nations. This machinery, when we start applying it, we may run into problems. We can deal with these through the dialogue with the Secretariat rather than go back to the Council once again and to enter into complications of adopting another resolution under Chapter 7.
أشار تقرير التقرير الذي أدلى به السيد الرئيس
The President, the statement of the President refer to Resolution 688. A number of representatives talked about the Kurds, the Shiites, and the alleged blockade against the three governorates and the international relief effort. We have considered, and we still consider Resolution 688, we have considered this resolution as a blatant interference in the internal affairs of Iraq. This is our position of principle vis-à-vis this resolution. However, in spite of this, and when the Secretary General of the United Nations proposed sending an executive delegate to coordinate the relief effort, and he named Prince Sadruddin Khan for this mission, Iraq cooperated. We signed with him last year a memorandum of understanding, which expired on December 1991 and was renewed for 6 more months, ending next June. During this period, there were positive work relations, positive business relations between us and Prince Khan and his representatives, and with the people who took on the responsibility after the mission of Prince Khan has ended. The international relief effort goes on according to a certain scope in Iraq, and the Iraqi authorities are cooperating with all international agencies and organizations which extend aid and assistance to our people in all areas of Iraq. It was alleged that there was a blockade imposed on three governorates. Here I'd like to make it clear before the Council I'd like to make clear the following.
في شهر نيسان الماضي
last April
دخلنا في حوار مع قيادة الجبهة الكردستانية.
We started a dialogue with the front in Kurdistan.
من شهر نيسان
this dialogue
ابريل
continued from April
شهر آب أغسطس
to August.
توصلنا نتيجة لهذا الحوار البناء
because of this constructive dialogue which took place in Baghdad
قادة الأحزاب
in which the leaders of the Kurdish parties Mr. Masoud Barzani, Mr. Jalal Talabani and others have taken part. I say because of this dialogue we're able to reach a new formula, a developed formula for autonomy for the Kurds in Iraq.
We
also reached an agreement on the naturalization of the situation, normalization of the situation in Kurdistan, namely to solve all problems of the previous years. After the end of the dialogue in August, the leadership of the Kurdistan Front asked to go back to Kurdistan to study the outcome of the dialogue. When they went there, and I affirm before the council, they were asked to send a delegation to a number of capitals. A delegation headed by Mr. Jalal Talabani went to Washington, to London, and after his return from these two capitals, we were told that the leadership of the Kurdistan Front was not ready at present to sign the accord. Thereafter, were acts of sabotage and destruction against the government authorities in that area. This made it imperative upon the government to withdraw the administrative apparatus from Sulaymaniyya, Erbil and Duhok, because they were no longer able to assume their normal functions as an administrative apparatus. The withdrawal of that administrative apparatus from the governorates led to the fact that the government cannot pay the salary of an employee who lives in Erbil directly, namely the accountant cannot pay the salary of that salaried employee in the city of Erbil, but that employee can come to Mosul or Kirkuk where there is an administrative apparatus, an administrative authority that can pay him or her their salary. This also applies to the supplies rationed by the government. The government cannot distribute these rations in villages and cities where there is no administrative apparatus. We distribute in a just and fair and comprehensive manner in all areas that are under the authority of the government. Namely, there's a governor, a representative of the Ministry of Trade, a police station, and other administrative apparatus. What are we doing now? Rations for these three governments are given to certain caterers in the area. They receive these rations and we have no idea how they distribute these rations. This area is controlled by Kurdish parties. Therefore, they bear the responsibility if the distribution is comprehensive or just, if the quantities are stolen or given to the citizens. This is not the responsibility of the central government. Mr. President, there is no blockade of these provinces. I say there are precautionary measures. The distinguished representative of the United States referred to the presence of checkpoints. Yes, they exist. But what is their task?
أعضاء مجلس الشيوخ الأمريكي زار المنطقة.
A U.S. senator visited that area.
وقال إن العراق.
And said.
يخرق قرارات مجلس الأمن.
That Iraq is violating Security Council resolutions. I went to Sulaymaniyah.
ووجدت كمية هائلة من المعدات الرافعات والتراكتورات والسيارات وغيرها.
A large number of tractors, trailers and cars. And Iraq wants to export them to Iran. Therefore, it is violating the boycott.
يا سيادة الرئيس.
As a matter of fact, Mr. President, the fact is, these equipment, which are very important for the life of the Iraqi people, were not there because the central government, central Iraqi government, wants to export them to Iran, but these were stolen from the state or from the citizens and moved there to be smuggled into Iran and sold there. We are a country under siege. When a car is stolen from Baghdad or a tractor is stolen from Mosul, when a lever is or any other equipment is stolen, we cannot make up for that. We cannot buy another one. If it has been moved to the northern part where we don't have any authority, we don't have any police, we don't have any customs, these get smuggled into Iran and other countries. We have a right to protect the wealth of our people by placing checkpoints. When a person comes and he wants to move a tractor from Baghdad or Erbil or Mosul, we ask him, why? What are you going to use it for there? If his papers are valid and if his position is perfectly clear, then we allow him to do this. But if he wants to smuggle it, it is only natural that we prevent him from smuggling. These are precautionary measures, I said, in protecting the property of the Iraqi people and the Iraqi state. Under the pretext of the not normal situation in the northern part, Allied forces stayed there for several months. Then they withdrew. They are now stationed in Angelik base in Turkey. Allied aircraft go in reconnaissance missions in the area. These aircraft sometimes will at a very low altitude over Mosul in a very provocative manner. And on Fridays, and during the performance of the Friday prayers, in a manner that spreads horror among the civilian population. The outcome of these provocative raids was certain abortion cases among women, pregnant women, These reconnaissance flights were not asked for by the Security Council. Three countries took that decision unilaterally. This exploration required this flying at very low altitude and in a manner, in a very provocative manner that spreads horror among the civilian population. Some talked about the so-called Shia problem in Iraq and the persecution of the Shiites. I'd like to say in front of you, and I'd like to say before history, I'd like to recall to you facts that are known by every Iraqi, Arab and Muslim, that in the history of Islam, since the beginning of the dawn of Islam and until today, there is no such thing as can be called sectarian wars as happened in Europe between the Catholics and the Protestants. This is a fact that is known by every historian who has any idea about Arab or Islamic history. Yes, there are schools of thought, there are religious schools, philosophic schools in Islam, but these doctrines have never, in the history of Islamic or Arab history, have never led to sectarian wars. I affirm Islamic and Arab history, they never ever converted into sectarian strikes. Iraq, Mr. President, is 6,000 years old. This long age, this long time civilization has resulted in a diversity of population, diversity of culture, diversity of religion. This is a fact. Iraq is composed of Arabs, Kurds, Turkmen, a minority that speaks the old Turkish dialect, Muslims, Sunnis, Shiites, Christians, Catholics, Orthodox, Protestants, Anglicans, a diverse society, sects, religions, and nationalities. But this society never engaged in a sectarian strife or a sectarian war. Life among all Iraqis is based on brotherliness. Maybe there will be some political differences, but never on the basis of a religious doctrine, Sunnis, Shiites, Christians or Muslims. Those who talk about this problem, are claiming what is unjust against Iraq and using it for political aims. There is no Shiite problem in Iraq. Look at our delegation, at this delegation of ours. This delegation, which we have not chosen on a sectarian basis, we have named the delegation according to the responsibilities. It's a delegation that represents the Iraqi government, that is headed by a deputy prime minister who is Catholic, Christian Catholic. Ministers, ambassadors, and technicians who are Shiite, Sunnis, and Kurds. This is our life in Iraq, Mr. President. We do not have a sectarian strife inside Iraq. This is a lie. A lie which aims at achieving political objectives to destabilize the Iraqi government. As regards the situation in Ahwar, Ahwar is a swamp area in the marshes
وتحاذي دولة مجاورة.
It is an area which is next to a neighboring country. As you know, in the marshes there are forests of sugarcane.
يمكن أن يختفي المجرمون.
In this area, criminals may
ويمكن أيضا
hide, outlaws
يكون فيها
may seek refuge,
لديهم أهداف
and also
سياسة.
Other persons that may have political
وهي
objectives.
متصلة بدولة مجاورة.
I say this area is adjacent to another country, another neighboring country, namely Iran. It is regrettable that Iran still plays the game of interference in the internal affairs of Iraq. This is the problem of the marshes. Isn't it the right of the authority to take measures to stop these armed people from coming from a neighboring country to destabilize security and stability in Iraq? Yes, this is the right of the authority. It has the right to take precautionary measures to preserve and maintain security and stability in the country and the area.
المسألة الأخيرة التي وردت
The final question which was raised in the statement was a reference to terrorism. Iraq has affirmed its commitment in this respect. Iraq has never not at any time has never practiced terrorism. There is not a single piece of evidence that Iraq has taken part in an operation of such
kind.
In conclusion, the final comment on your statement, Mr. President, I would like to make what I think is a legitimate request. You are meeting once every 2 months to review the situation of Iraq's compliance with provisions of Security Council resolutions. After this review, you pass your judgment. We request the Council that we be allowed to appear here before you every 2 months to take part in that review, that you give us an opportunity to explain our position vis-a-vis your interests. If you have remarks on the extent of the compliance by Iraq with this particular item or the other of the provisions of the resolution, give us the opportunity, the chance to explain our position. Just as you've given us this chance yesterday and today, and we feel that it is an invaluable opportunity, and we thank the Council for this, and we appreciate this very much. Yesterday, Mr. President,
وجه إلي عدد من الأسئلة
I was asked
من قبل
various questions
أعضاء المجلس
by the distinguished representatives in the council.
السيد السفير الهندي المحترم
the distinguished representative of India referred to the question of detainees.
الإيضاح الذي قدمته
I hope the clarification that I made in my statement would be sufficient. I would like to affirm to the distinguished representative of India that Iraq would do its utmost to solve this problem. We said that we have given the file to the Red Cross. Namely, we have given the whole mission to the Red Cross so that the International Committee can undertake all the investigations and take all measures to put an end to that question and submit a report to the Council on that question. The distinguished representative of France
أسئلة.
I posed three questions.
الأول هو حول الصورة الكاملة والشاملة.
One on the complete and comprehensive picture of Iraq's military program. When Iraq will provide this full picture. In my statement yesterday.
البيان الذي الإيضاح الذي أدليت به.
And in the clarification that I made this morning. I mentioned that we were ready to enter immediately into talks with the Special Commission and the IAEA to finally reach this full and comprehensive picture. The second question is
سيعرض العراق مجلس الأمن على قبوله غير المشروط بخطة الرصد كما وردت في القرار.
When Iraq will tell the Security Council of its unconditional acceptance of the monitoring plan in Security Council Resolution 715, I dealt with this in my statement yesterday and in my statement again this morning, and I believe that the proposals that I've made, as well as the points that I've clarified, need no further explanation. The third question had to do with Resolution 688, and I hope that my answer this morning had covered this question as well. There were other questions made by the distinguished representative of the United States, and I will deal with them one after the other.
سؤال الأول, when will Iraq make full, final, and complete disclosure of its programs of weapons of mass destruction? لقد أجبت على هذا السؤال.
I have answered this question in my statement this morning.
Is Iraq prepared to commence destruction of its ballistic missile production and repair facilities as requested by the Special Commission letter of February 14 and under UN supervision. لقد قدمت في هذا الاجتماع.
Once again in this meeting and in the meeting yesterday, I have made proposals in this respect.
عن عموم ونقاط مبدئية.
And we talked about basic points of principle that we hope that the Council would take into consideration. And especially I'd like to affirm that we should reach this full list. I repeat, reaching a full comprehensive list.
When will Iraq return to the IAEA nuclear documents seized from the never returned to the 6th inspection team in September 1991? لا توجد مثل هذه الوثائق.
We do not have these documents. They don't exist. We are ready to engage into a dialogue with the agency in that particular respect.
There's
a question on Resolution 715, and I have dealt with that in my statement this morning and in my statement yesterday. There's a question on the Commission of the Demarcation of the Borders. The report made to the Council never referred to any of these problems, and it is regrettable that some members have thought that there were problems, but the statement of the President and the report of the Secretary General never referred to any of these problems. And I believe we should leave it at the report. Another question to do with the five police posts, and I have dealt with this in my statement today. There is a question of three or four parts that have to do with the detainees, refugees, and humanitarian aspects. I have dealt with that question in my statement yesterday and in my statement today. There's another question on Resolution 706 and 712, and I have covered this in my statement as well.
When will Iraq permit the establishment of UN humanitarian centers throughout Iraq, including Kirkuk and Mosul?
Another question includes an accusation. It is not really a question.
Will Iraq cease attacks on civilians, including artillery bombardment of urban areas?
This is an accusation, and it's not a question, and I reject that accusation.
There's
a question on the marshes, and I've dealt with that. Question of
when will Iraq make a final accounting of and return all of both the military and non-military property taken from Kuwait?
This was dealt with in the report in a very clear manner. Iraq has already returned most of the property, and some of them were military.
There's
a question on Resolution 706, and I've dealt with that comprehensively. Now I deal with the questions made by the distinguished representative of the United Kingdom. The beginning of his statement, the distinguished representative of the United Kingdom said cynically on the remark by Mr. Atisari, which I referred to in my statement when Atisari came to Iraq. He said that Iraq was sent back to pre-industrial revolution age and will remain as such for a long time. The British ambassador wondered, how is that true when Iraq continued on its nuclear program? I would like to affirm before the Council that Iraq was not continuing any industrial program, be it civilian or military, when Atisari was in Iraq. Yes, there were certain equipment left from the previous stage, but Iraq was not activating any
activity in this field or any other field.
Because when Atisari visited Baghdad in March 1991, there was no electricity to make plants work. There was not enough fuel even for the citizens to fuel their cars. Purification stations for water were bombed. The bridges in the capital, in the villages, even remote villages, were destroyed. The description by Atisari, who is not Iraqi, and by the way, he's not a member of the Iraqi Ba'ath Party, was a description of what he saw of other people who were with him, who were fair, and described what they saw. The distinguished British ambassador, in his first question, said that Tariq Aziz said in his statement, mentioned in his statement 4 points on Iraq's readiness to continue cooperation and Iraq's readiness to provide new information, etc. Then said that Tariq Aziz said that these requests or these points of readiness
do this on the basis of respect to its sovereignty and dignity and of non-infringement upon its national security, and on this basis not allowing the objectives stipulated in resolution 687 to be turned into means of preventing our people and country from living its free normal life like all other free people in the world. Sayyid Safir al-Britani قال هل هذه شروط.
The distinguished British ambassador said, are these conditions that you take with your left hand what you've given with your right? Mr. Ambassador, there isn't a single free country in the world, and Iraq is a free country and an independent country, and cherishes its independence, not just now, for a long time, and you know this. Iraq does not negotiate its independence or sovereignty. This is not a matter for bargaining. We are ready to cooperate with the Security Council, yes. Ready to cooperate with the Special Commission, yes. Ready to cooperate with the IAEA, yes. To achieve the objectives provided for in Resolution 687, but we are not bargaining over our sovereignty. We are not bargaining over our right to live as a free, independent people, a people that has contributed to human civilization for 6,000 years.
سؤال ثاني يقول point D on page 9 of Mr. Tariq Aziz's statement refers only to the equipment covered by the provisions of paragraph 8 of resolution 687. This excludes the nuclear equipment which is covered by paragraph 12 of resolution 687. Is this a deliberate omission or an oversight? It is an oversight, Mr. Ambassador, because I was dealing with the report of the 28th of February. I was not addressing other issues. We have accepted resolution 687 and that acceptance is comprehensive. سؤال الثالث Mr. Tariq Aziz suggested question. That Security Council should be involved in technical discussions on weapons of mass destruction. It must be clear from the President's opening statement today and from the presidential statement of the 28th of February that it is not for the Council to become involved in the detail of decisions by the Special Commission and the IAEA. If decisions are taken on these matters by the Special Commission and the IAEA, will Iraq implement them? This is hypothetical. نحن قدمنا مقترحات واعتبارات مبدئية.
We have provided for certain suggestions and proposals which were legitimate and logical. We submitted these to the Council and we are still waiting for the Council to take them into consideration. We hope that the Council would consider our requests and our proposals of principle which are legitimate, logical and practical. We hope that the Council would take these into consideration and we are here in New York ready to continue our contacts with the Special Commission, with the IAEA, and with you to reach a fair and equitable solution, one that is compatible with the letter and spirit of Resolution 687 on this subject. The fourth question I already dealt with when I discussed Resolution 706. Mr. President, I would like to thank you for your attention and to thank the distinguished members on the Council for allowing me this opportunity to speak before you today to answer the questions that were submitted yesterday. I would like to reconfirm that I stand fully ready to answer any other question in this meeting or in any other coming meeting that you might wish to decide. We wish to reach a clear understanding of all what has to do with the provisions of Resolution 687. We would not want to leave any confusion between us and the Council. We would like to separate the accusations, the doubts, and the political positions from the factual realities relevant to the implementation of the provisions of the resolution. This is our objective. This has been our objective ever since we arrived in New York. I have told the press, and I told Your Excellency, I also told His Excellency the Secretary General, and reconfirmed today that our mission here is a goodwill mission. We will remain acting in this pretext. Thank you, sir.
I thank the distinguished Deputy Prime Minister of Iraq, His Excellency Mr. Tariq Aziz, for his statement. Does any member of the Council wish to address further questions to the distinguished Deputy Prime Minister of Iraq?
Ambassador Pickering of the United States has the floor.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. Obviously, what we have heard this morning presents us with a great deal of material, a seeming sense that there may be some new elements. Essentially, I heard a repetition of a great deal of what has been said before. There are some obvious changes. We would all welcome, once again, the reopening of contacts between Iraq and the Secretariat, previously shut down by Iraq on the implementation of Resolutions 706 and 712. We have known for some time, and indeed your statement, Mr. President, and mine, indicated that we were both aware of specific written acceptance by Iraq of commitments under Resolution 687, dated on April 11th, 1991. We wonder why we are still here talking about Iraq's commitments and obligations being fulfilled under that resolution. And once again, we hear, unfortunately, that Iraq wishes to meet and negotiate these commitments. Once again, there is broad and general acceptance of a resolution, but with all kinds of new provisos, reservations, preconditions, and so forth. Once again, I would remind the distinguished Deputy Prime Minister of Iraq that these are mandatory resolutions, that they must be complied with in full, that there has now been a long period of 11 months, extensive discussions with the Special Commission and with the IAEA, all of which I think have made clear what is required. There is a seeming indication that a little negotiation will provide a full and complete declaration. But of course, it is Iraq that knows what it had in its arsenal, what it was building, and what production equipment was available to do that on the 2nd of August of 1990, and indeed on every single date at every single hour subsequent to that time. We still haven't seen that list. It is not up to the Special Commission to produce that list. It is up to Iraq. Similarly, it is Iraq that is to cooperate in the destruction of the programs. After extensive discussion with the Special Commission, Iraq is still resisting the destruction of the essential elements of the production machinery for its ballistic missile program. And finally, it appears once again that Iraq wishes to sit and negotiate with us over the long-term monitoring program, as if that were not clear. That program is contained in the resolutions of the Council. That program has been set forth clearly by the Special Commission and by the IAEA, and we would have liked to have heard a full, clear, uncomplicated, and basic commitment on the part of Iraq to accept that program and comply with it. There are many other areas of discussion, some I think quite interesting. Nevertheless, I am left with the final and unfortunate conclusion that with respect not only to weapons of mass destruction, but to all the other elements of the resolution, including the very important humanitarian elements, we are once again in a cat and mouse game, that there is every willingness to discuss at great length, but no willingness to accept the need for compliance, much less to begin the actions to comply. I think this is unfortunate. As I said yesterday, I believe it is a miscalculation. And I hope that that miscalculation doesn't continue. Thank you, Mr. President.
I thank the Ambassador of the United States of America. Does any other member of the Council wish to address questions to the distinguished Deputy Prime Minister of Iraq? The representative of the United Kingdom has the floor.
Mr. President, thank you for giving me the floor. I do not wish to pose more questions. I thank the Deputy Prime Minister for the answers he gave, although I'm bound to register that in some of them they were frankly evasive and therefore not satisfactory. But I feel that this exchange has shown that these problems of compliance will never be resolved by words. They will have to be resolved by deeds. And insofar as the Deputy Prime Minister has shown some willingness on one or two points to indicate a shift in the position of his government, I feel these will have to be put to the test by deeds. It is in the work that now has to continue to be done by the IAEA and the Special Commission. It is in the work that is being done by the ICRC, and it is in the work done by the Secretary General in the humanitarian area and in the implementation of Resolution 688, that we will see whether these have been put to the test and are producing compliance, or whether we are simply confronted with a continuation of the non-compliance which has been the history of the last year. So I hope very much that it will be the former and not the latter, because, as I said yesterday, I think the latter would be a major miscalculation. Thank you, Mr. President.
I thank the Ambassador of the United Kingdom, and I give the floor to the representative of Japan.
Thank you, Mr. President. The fate of Kuwaiti and third country nationals in Iraq is a major concern to my country. A question was asked yesterday on visits by the ICRC to places of detention in Iraq, especially on whether the visits can be conducted in accordance with ICRC standard procedures. I'm not quite sure if the general answer just given by the distinguished Deputy Prime Minister regarding cooperation with ICRC covers this specific point of great importance. We will carefully follow the developments on this particular point and may raise this subject again in future Security Council discussion. Thank you.
I thank Ambassador Hatano of Japan. Does any other member of the Council wish to address questions to the Deputy Prime Minister of Iraq? If not, with the concurrence of the members of the Council, I intend to suspend the meeting now. I invite members to join me for consultations immediately. The meeting is suspended. The 3,059th meeting of the Security Council is resumed. In concluding the present stage of the consideration of the item on the agenda,
I have been authorized, following consultations among members of the Security Council, to make the following statement on behalf of the Council.
Tras haber sido expresadas las opiniones del Consejo de Seguridad,
the views of the Security Council, having been expressed through its president and by the statements of its members on the extent of compliance by the government of Iraq with its obligations under the relevant Security Council resolutions, the Security Council has listened with close attention to the statement by the Deputy Prime Minister of Iraq and his responses to the questions posed by Council members. The members of the Security Council wish to reiterate their full support for the statement made by the President of the Council on their behalf at the opening of the 3059th meeting, S-23699. In the view of the Security Council, the government of Iraq has not yet complied fully and unconditionally with those obligations, must do so, and must immediately take the appropriate actions in this regard. It hopes that the goodwill expressed by the Deputy Prime Minister of Iraq will be matched by deeds.
Fin de la declaración del Consejo de Seguridad. Antes de levantar la sesión,
end of statement by the Security Council. I wish to inform you before concluding this meeting that the representative of the Islamic Republic of Iran has transmitted a communication to me in connection with this item, which I will have circulated among members. The Security Council has thus concluded the present stage of its consideration of the item on the agenda. The Security Council will remain seized of the matter. The meeting is adjourned.